The big, huge artists that sell big on the art market now, the ones who sell for millions at Sotheby's and Christie's, the one who get bought by Saatchi, will not be remembered 100 years from now. You often hear artists say that you should know the rules before you can break them. When they say that, they are thinking of the artists who seem to be breaking the rules, and yet they arrive at successful image designs. People like Picasso and Cézanne had traditional, proper and thorough training in figurative art before they started making paintings in which it seemed that they had discarded the rules the academies had taught them. In this video, I will explain why I think this is the wrong way of looking at it. In Cézanne's time, an artist had to make paintings that would do well in the Grand National Official Art Exhibitions, also called the Art Salons. It was very competitive, and since he was a man of means, and therefore not as hungry as the other artists, he decided to spend his time finding a solution to a new problem, one that had arisen in the arts recently. The tube of paint had been invented, and this allowed artists to go outside and paint in plein air. What they discovered, to their shock, was that the lighting was very, very, very different from the lighting inside a studio. In a studio, you typically had one source of light, and because of that, one side of the object or model would be dark, and the object would cast a shadow. Artists would play with these shadows and modify them and create areas in the shadow where it was light and vice versa to get at interesting abstract visual designs for the composition. But outside, that turned out to not be possible. The sun just lit everything evenly. There was no dramatic shadow like you had in the studio. If you go outside and you look at a face, it will typically be relatively evenly lit and with much less shade and shadow than inside a studio, because the sunlight just reflects from everywhere to everywhere. There is a lot of ambient light outside. So how do you go about getting design back into your composition if you can't play with the shadows? This is the problem Cézanne set out to solve. One thing he came up with was to let go of the accuracy of an outline. For example, he made a painting, a fruit bowl, glass and apples, where he paints a bowl in such a way that the top side of the bowl is seriously deformed, effectively turning it into a more interesting two-dimensional shape and creating a more interesting negative space and overall improved composition. Imagine having been trained to draw things formally and accurately and then to dare deform things on the canvas, to turn a perfectly cylindrical bowl into more of a blob because that suited the painting better. Did he break any rules of art? You would think so, but that is not actually what happened. Note that he had a traditional training and that he could perfectly well paint a proper cylinder and symmetrical bowl if he had wanted to. It was an artistic choice. He had made a decision to not follow that so-called rule. He chose not to. What he did was decide that good composition design was more important for him than accuracy in representing the correct outline of an object. Looking at all the things he could focus on, he simply chose to make one thing more important than another thing. He put composition design above accuracy of representation in his list of priorities. That was a conscious decision. It was an artistic decision. That is why it is important to know these rules. You have to be able to apply them so that not applying them becomes an artistic choice. He came up with a new solution to an artistic problem. One of my strong convictions is that this is why we remember artists. When you think of all the artists we still know, the Rembrandts and such, they all came up with interesting new solutions to creative problems. We still remember them because they came up with solutions to artistic problems which artists still use today. Rembrandt discovered many things, but amongst them are the realization that you should portray people as they really are, and that you should not try to make brushstrokes invisible. Rather, brushstrokes can be beautiful in and of themselves, and their skillful placement helps enhance the piece considerably. Many artists who work today are indebted to these artists who came up with these clever solutions. We remember Cézanne, who came up with new solutions to artistic problems, but we don't remember Cézanne's contemporaries, who painted one reclining nude after the other. I think the same will happen for our time. The big, huge artists that sell big on the art market now, the ones who sell for millions at Sotheby's and Christie's, the one who get bought by Saatchi, will not be remembered 100 years from now. I would not be surprised, though, if someone like Kim Jong-gi was still remembered 100 years from now. He really has discovered a new way of looking at how to draw from imagination, which is, essentially, to train your visual memory and to draw from memory. Artists will be using and applying this amazing insight for centuries to come. In this video, you can see me kind of trying to draw in this linear style, directly with a pen. Kim Jong-gi showed that this type of thing can be done at all, and many other artists are now trying and doing it. I am inspired by it too. Kim Jong-gi will be remembered. Takashi Murakami, who basically mass produces visual pieces for rich people who don't know the first thing about art, won't be remembered as much 100 years from now. We don't know all the artists who came up with these solutions. We know Filippo Brunelleschi was the first to use linear perspective, but we don't know who the first Greek artist was who discovered foreshortening, for example. But we do collect all that knowledge. For at least the past 70,000 years, humans have been making art and discovering clever solutions for artistic problems. And they handed this information from one generation to the next. And then the 20th century happened. Artists started focusing on abstract art and concept, and students didn't get proper training at academies anymore, and you really can see it in what is produced nowadays. Fortunately, all that knowledge artists discovered in the past is not completely lost. We can rediscover it in their drawings and paintings, and some of the knowledge was passed along in writing or by word of mouth still. But you can see that many artists who graduate from Art Academy haven't been taught these things. I saw an exhibit in the Centre Pompidou with works from Gerhard Richter, and it depressed me a lot. He is among the highest paid artists in the world, and his abstract works are actually nice to look at, but his figurative work is just not very good. You can see that he lacks the knowledge all the past artists had discovered. You can see that he knows and sees that himself too, that he is failing. You can see the frustration in his paintings. When he copies a photograph and then wipes the painting, his copy of past masterpieces is just clumsy. Don't get me wrong, I have nothing against Gerhard Richter. He is just having fun in his studio, like I am doing too. We are both just having fun and failing in our studios. It is the art world I have a problem with, where the Takashi Murakamis and the Gerhard Richters of this world fetch high prices with their pieces. You can see that these artists don't know these so-called rules, the solutions to artistic problems that past artists had discovered. Which rules you are expected to adhere by also very much depends on the time you live in and the industry you're in. In Cézanne's time, it was custom to draw human flesh with lines that curved inward. Convex lines only. These convex lines convey flesh effectively. Even if you had a part where the outline seemed to be concave, curving out like the hollow of your foot, they would draw that by building it up from smaller convex lines. Artists nowadays don't apply that rule as much anymore. In contrast, nowadays there is this rule that you should avoid tangents. A tangent is when one object touches another and it reduces the sense of depth in your piece. I think this rule came up in the animation industry 100 years ago or so, and if you copy illustrations from artists from the Golden Age of Illustration, which was just before that, you can see that they didn't quite adhere to that rule. There were tangents all over the place. And yet, the illustrations were amazing. Also, there are modern works where this rule is not used, yet the piece works. For example, there was one painting where the person who was depicted in it touches the frame, which actually helps convey a claustrophobic feeling. You do have to know the why of these rules, so that you know when not to apply them. I read the great book How to Write Funny by Scott Dickers, and in it he presents the process of coming up with jokes. In short, write morning pages every day, just keep writing, just write, and then look back and see if there are any jokes there or strong opinions on things. If you have a joke, make sure it says something you want to say. He then defines 11 what he calls funny filters, and then he goes about explaining how to apply these filters to create or enhance a joke, and how you can apply several filters to enhance the joke, but you certainly don't have to apply them all or equally. You can apply some irony and maybe introduce a character with exaggerated character flaw, or you can add a touch of shock, maybe wordplay. The thing about his way of talking about it that stuck with me was that it was almost as if he was designing a recipe for a dish. You can't have too much irony, you can't have too much character, but be careful with shock. If you add shock to your joke, then add just a dash of shock, not too much. That is the same with cooking too. You can't have too much avocado in a salad, but you can have too much salt. Add just a dash of salt, if any, but you should not add all the ingredients you have in your kitchen. And I think the same goes with art. The rules are part of the ingredients you can use. Emphasizing one thing more means emphasizing something else less. Do you want to create a sense of depth? Then you should use perspective and avoid tangents. Or do you want to reduce the sense of depth? Then maybe use a flat background and do use tangents. Do you want to design a great abstract composition? Then work in black, white and a few midtones. Don't have a lot of tonal contrast to work with? Try color and try deforming shapes like Cezanne did. You are not breaking any rules by not applying them to your current piece. Just like you are not breaking any avocado by not adding it to your current meal. It is just an ingredient you may or may not decide to use in the thing you're making. Decide which rules have higher priority, or let's call them ingredients from now on. Draw a face portrait very accurately, constructing it carefully, and then add a dash of loosely placed lines to suggest clothing. Carefully add some ingredients together and keep tasting that dish, keep trying to figure out which ingredient it needs more of. More tonal contrast, more color, more accurate anatomy. They are the ingredients that go into your piece. They are not rules and you are not breaking them, just deciding whether to and how much to use them in a piece. Malevich was an artist who eventually decided that paintings could be just that, paintings, abstract shapes on a canvas. They didn't have to be representational. They didn't have to serve that purpose, he thought. He ended up arriving at the ultimate painting, just a rectangular canvas painted entirely black. For me, it means he just didn't want to add the ingredient of representation to his painting. I don't think it was a truth deeper than that. Other artists may want to make their images representational, but it is perfectly fine if an artist wants to leave out that ingredient. Like how a vegetarian avoids adding meat to their meals, other people might still want to add meat to their dishes. It's a chef's choice, an artist's choice, not a rule. Another example is the use of black in an image. In the past, painters like Rembrandt would avoid using pure black. They wanted to still be able to suggest volume and texture, and you can't do that if you go full black. They would even lighten cast shadows in order to give them value range to be able to suggest volume. Then, in the 20th century, artists made comics for print, and offset print, as they used it then for newspaper print, was pure black or white. Noel Sickles discovered that you could effectively make dramatic storytelling images by using large black abstract shapes, going deep black. I remember being confused by that. Wasn't you supposed to not go full black? Another one of those so-called rules. They are ingredients in painting, but also in illustration. You can decide to not go full black so that you can suggest volume and texture, or you can decide that you do want to go full black for dramatic effect, to give your work a graphic quality. They are just ingredients that you might or might not want to add to your creation. Glenn Villepoux says, "There are no rules, only tools," which conveys the same idea, that there are no hard rules that you have to always follow when it comes to art. You can see them as tools to apply to improve an image. I like to see them as ingredients because it suggests a food dish as a metaphor. You get to decide which ingredients to add and how much to create your composition. I think the ingredients metaphor is a good metaphor, because you can put too much of an ingredient in a meal And the same is true for a work of art. You can add too much of an ingredient. For me, abstract art has too much abstraction and too little representation for my liking. Too much realism, in my opinion, is also less interesting because the work then just represents something without saying anything about it. I like the idea of seeing a work of art as a bunch of ingredients added together skillfully by an artist, like a cook adds ingredients to a meal. In contrast, you can't apply a tool too much. On the other hand, we as humans create tools to solve problems, and these ingredients are often solutions to artistic problems. But I think we artists discovered them, like we discovered food ingredients, things we found in nature which we discovered we could eat. We didn't engineer food ingredients, at least not yet, like we engineered tools. Go in search of your own solutions to artistic problems, see if there are problems you encounter, and experiment and try out different possible solutions to the problem. Experiment in your sketchbook and try to discover your own solutions, and maybe artists will remember and celebrate you 500 years from now. Wouldn't that be cooler than having many likes on a platform that will probably not be around in 10 years? I played this video in real time, so that you, if you like, could watch this video again and draw along with me. Watching and listening to tutorials is a great way to learn about how to make art, but you need to draw also. Grab a pen and paper, restart the video and make the marks along with me as we draw this together. Thank you for watching and listening, and I hope you will try drawing along with me.